Welcome to the Collector's Catacomb, episode number 20. Sorry I missed everybody last week. Life got in the way, but I want to especially thank Dan and Erik and Drew for holding down the fort for episode number 19. So we're on to episode number 20. It's hard to believe we're already 20 episodes into this adventure. But here we are tonight. We're going to talk about a little bit of this, a little bit of that. No real set schedule, a little bit of mid-century modern, talk some Militaria. I got a new clock behind me. Talk about...
That's the whole hour and a half, the clock, right?
Yeah. No, about an hour and 29 minutes. I got at least 30 seconds apiece for you guys, you know. But Dan's got some cool stuff tonight. Erik didn't even say what he had. We were chatting, but
it's all gonna be a surprise. Nah, nothing. It's all military related, so.
Okay, no worries. So, and then I don't know where Drew's at. I'm sure he'll show up, hopefully with his shirt on.
He was jealous about your clock, so he said, "I can't compete with that," and didn't bother.
Right.
Yeah. He ran out the cool really quick.
Right.
He went out to the thrift store. Yeah.
Yeah. Probably won't find that clock in a thrift store. You can buy it. So here we are, episode number 20. So my name's Erik. I collect mostly Militaria, specifically 38th Infantry Regiment. I also collect a small plethora of other items that catch my interest until somebody pays me more than I paid for them, and then they're gone again. And I collect something else. But yeah, so basically we get together every week, we talk about our collections. Sometimes we get a guest on the interview, so if you want to come on, talk about your collection, get interviewed a little bit, and share with other folks, then more than welcome to. We talk about anything that's collectible, so, and the collectors that collect it, and the history behind it all. So let me go ahead and get you introduced to the rest of my panel. We'll start off the evening with my master of ceremonies, Cooltoads. What's up, Sean?
Hey, how's it going? I am Cooltoads. I sell on eBay and Amazon, and I have my channel is Cooltoads, and then I have a show on Friday nights called Toadcast, and pretty much that's it. I don't live much of a life. Not as exciting as these guys have. I don't have collections, so.
See, Sean, we just got to get you collecting something, man. You got to collect smalls, like... Collect little made-in-Japan figurines.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And you can collect a lot of them in a small space.
Or collect beer bottles that you empty yourself.
There you go.
There you go. Yeah. Beer caps.
Yeah, beer caps, which you collect. Yeah.
Or, you know, we could go straight 70s, collect matchbooks and a giant wine glass.
I have a whole bunch of matchbooks.
And a giant brandies.
2,000 baseball cards that are worthless.
Yeah. There you go.
I have about 120 leftover wooden nickels. I do have some collections, but. Yeah.
Those beanie babies, they're going to fly off the shelf one day. You'll see.
Yep. I burned that shit.
I have one beanie baby.
Right? Well, since we're talking about beanie babies, let's go to Mr. Beanie Baby himself. Erik, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Hi, my name is Erik Cashlin. I'm a Militaria collector. I have a Facebook page, Militaria Collectors of Delaware Valley. I'm also on Allied Military Forum, which is a forum run by our host here, Mr. Erik Castle. And that's pretty much it. I like to focus on military and history, and you know, every now and then I'll pick up some other items that, you know, sparks my interest.
Awesome, Erik. Well, glad to have you here, and again, thanks for last week. And on to Dan at More Old Stuff.
Hello,
what you got, Dan?
How you doing, guys? This has been a kind of a cool week for collectors. We had Saturday was Free Comic Book Day.
Yes.
So you can go down to your comic book store and load up on tons of free comic books, which they had many segments now. This time that they did it, they do this every year, by the way. They had a lot of limited edition comic books that were given out at certain stores on Comic Book Day. So you'll right away, you got a free collection that is worth something probably the next day, because the guys that didn't get them in their stores were getting them in, you know, and you got them in yours. So now you got something that's valuable. Then, of course, What was May the 4th?
May the 4th be with you. Star Wars Day.
May the 4th be with you. That was Star Wars Day. And so, you know, a lot of sales going on in collectibles, a lot of online sales going on, mainly Star Wars collectibles and stuff like that. But anyhow, oh, and the last couple of, I think it was in this past week, was YouTube's 10th anniversary. So thanks to YouTube, we're doing what we're doing here. The very first YouTube video that was ever posted on YouTube 10 years ago was actually filmed at the San Diego Zoo, and it was of an elephant. And a guy, and it was one of the employees of YouTube at the time that filmed it. So that's, I just heard about it. So thanks to all of this, it puts us here on it. But I'm Dan at More Old Stuff. I have a YouTube channel where I share all of my hauls and collectibles. I do some reselling too. I'm I'm a collector over the reselling, of course, which makes it kind of hard when you're trying to resell stuff. But I've got collections of all kinds of stuff here. I got a Facebook group, which is in my little tagline down there. So if you want to join the group and get alerted when I do new videos and update stuff, and that group's open, you can share your collections, your finds, and all that kind of stuff. Your treasure hunting that you do, that's cool too. So anyhow.
Awesome, Dan. It's glad to have you here tonight. This should be a really great show. I was hoping Drew would pop in by now, but never know, missing in action. It's all right. It's all good. So I do definitely want to do some shout-outs tonight, so we're going to get Sean lined up here to do some shout-outs, and you know, hopefully Bonafide out there will calm down a little bit on all the pump and the iron and quit breaking his keyboard. I'm glad he likes the show, though. But, yeah, Sean, let's do some shout-outs. We got a nice full house tonight. Yeah. Thanks to the Golden Finger Picker. Apparently he was over-pimping us somewhere, you know.
Yeah, we got, we got Wade. Wade Harrod first. He beat Dan in here again. Yeah, so he was the first one here tonight. And then we have Joe Panico. A Turtle Trader, what's up? Welcome. And then Kathleen Brown, Berta Bell, Michelle Wood, PA Picker Dave, what's up, man? And I'm guessing it's Gigi Snyder, I don't know how to pronounce that properly. Welcome. And go a little further. Hold on. There we go. Is it Drain Swanson? See, I'm so sorry. Swamp Picker, what's up, man? Did I say Kathleen Brown? Hope so. Laura Lee, what's up? Jay Zepp. April D, what's up? Chad sent me, she says. Nora Knight, again, another Chad sent me. Bonafide Picker. And Green Mountain Picker, what's up, man? He's the one that first originally said hit the like button. And Chad Joseph Hare, what's up?
Chad must be handing out $20 bills. Is that what's going on?
He said free beer. I think there was a comment about free beer if they mentioned that they came
from. Off the top, Chad. I don't care what he gives away.
There's Michelle Wood.
Have him pay me to come back.
Hell yeah. DOG Picker, what's up, man? Jay Wise. Walking Picker, what's up, Chris? Welcome. Golden Finger Picker, speaking of the devil. Country Girl, how's it going? Marianne Wheelwright, what's up? Alvin Smith. And come on, there's others in here too, but it's there's a lot of people talking back and forth, so it'll get down there. UFO and I Flip, JC Elric, there we go. Yeah, there was a couple more in there.
Yeah, Working Fisherman, he said Chad paid me. Swamp Picker, free beer.
Yeah.
Berta Bell, I'm waiting on my $20. Man, cost Chad a lot of money in free beer. To.
Bama's man, he's in here. That's funny.
Oh, man. Well, I'm glad we got a crazy room tonight. I definitely like when the show's busy. Looked like we had a Sasquatch that jumped in here. I don't know where he went, though. It popped in. I don't know. I guess it's a mystery. So we'll just keep moving on. Thanks, Sean, for the shout-outs. And, hey, thanks, yep, everybody, for tuning in.
We're I missed here till a few, actually. Tonight.
What's up?
I missed a few. Millie Dominic.
Hit him up.
And Jenny KNF and White Shoal. Sorry about that, but they're in here as well.
Awesome. Well, like I said, we're glad to have everybody in here. Hopefully they'll stick with us tonight. So, without who wants to go up, Erik or Dan? Which one?
I'll kick off.
There we go. Beat Dan out of it. All right, Erik, go ahead and kick off.
All right, so I have a couple military pieces. Some of them are some stuff I actually picked up this weekend. I love the warmer weather because, you know, it's flea market and yard sale season, so, you know, it's prime picking time. Unfortunately, military and yard sales, you know, it's always a hit or miss. I very rarely have found anything. But I actually went to a reenactment this weekend, and, you know, they had some dealers set up there, so... And I was able to pick up a few patches and some other pieces. But the one interesting, I don't know if anybody knows, but, you know, during World War II and actually even today, a lot of patches were made overseas. So, you know, if you're a serviceman or woman that's overseas and, you know, you need a patch for your uniform or, you know, even a medal, you could go to... you know, a local shop, and it would actually make up patches for you, or, you know, have them already pre-made, and then, you know, you can buy them there. So, you know, it would be called, you know, theater made, or I'm sure Erik can attest to that, you know, having served and, you know, probably bought some theater made patches himself.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The ugliest American flag I own was made in Iraq.
Really? Wow. Okay.
Nice. It looked atrocious, but it got me by.
There you go. So this one piece kind of caught my eye. You know, I hope you can see this. So this is a World War II rank. Actually, they no longer use this rank, and this would be a T5 rank. So it would be kind of the equivalent to a corporal. But the interesting part about this, and I'm hoping we can get some of the detail, but it has kind of what's called a salt and pepper embroidery, you know, and it's embroidered on a, you know, a felt material. So the salt and pepper is, basically you'll see that on German-made patches. So this would be a patch made in Germany, probably immediately post World War II for a U.S. soldier. But the other interesting part is the material, and it's kind of a field gray or a feldgrau material, which looks like what they use to make German uniforms. So what likely happened was you had a small shop that was manufacturing uniforms for the Germans, and then once the war ended, they continued to use that same material to manufacture, you know, patches or, you know, other items for you know, U.S. servicemen. So that's always pretty cool, and, you know, here's the back of it here, and in the front. So it's just interesting, you know, it goes to show you, you know, they had this material, and they just had to keep using it to, you know, however they could. And U.S. servicemen were there, they were paying money, and, you know, that's what they did. So moving on, this is another theater-made piece, and this is a, you know, I'm sure Erik has one of these. This is the National Defense Service Medal.
Yeah.
Front and back, but
now that looks, is that a Vietnam one?
Well, here's the what it looks like now, or this is what it looks like since 1953 when it was originally issued,
right?
So, you know, it's got a, you know, the bright red, yellow, you know, etc. So, you know, this would have been issued for service, you know, through four campaigns or four you know, wars, so Korean War, yeah, Vietnam,
Right, it was issued during certain time periods.
Yeah, yeah.
Because there was a time period between, well, actually, I'm trying to think when we've had a blank time period. I don't think we have.
No, well, it's Korean War, Vietnam War, Persian Gulf War, and then the current global war on terrorism.
Right.
So if you served during any of those periods, yeah.
What's interesting is 95 is the switchover from Persian Gulf
to war on terror. Yeah.
Because you can actually get a star.
That's right. Yeah, if you served 95 and 96. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So it's rare. It's rare to have somebody who has multiple of the National Defense Medal, or today, I should say. You know, you don't have many guys that, you know, obviously there would be office, you know, high-ranking officers, I would assume, who were in that period of continued service, unless they were in that 95 to 96 transitional period, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, it's real common to find them with a single star.
Okay. Two stars would probably be,
would be somebody that was high ranking, because they would have been in before the Persian Gulf.
Yeah, exactly. So Vietnam, Vietnam, which I think the period runs up till 79 even. Yeah, so.
Like, well, Chad's got one of those. Chad served in the Gulf.
Yeah, okay. All right.
Yeah.
So what's interesting about this one is you can see it's a little bit different construction, and this is actually was made in Japan. So it's not, you know, so this isn't your standard U.S.-made, U.S.-issue metal. It was actually made in Japan. So, you know, it's uncommon. It just goes to show you again, you know, if you were overseas, you know, serving overseas, even, you know, obviously this wouldn't have been made during any conflict with Japan. So it was somebody who was serving, you know, in Japan, likely during or right after Vietnam. And, you know, they went to a shop and, you know, they had available to them. Whoops.
Do you got any Vietnam made?
No, not National Defense, but I have some Vietnam, you know, like, I actually showed them last week. They're Vietnam issue medals, so it was a Cross of Gallantry, and, you know, but I know there is a Vietnam made version of the National Defense Service.
Yeah, the color pattern looks really similar to
It is. Even the construction. Yeah, even the construction of the material looks. That's what I thought it was. I thought it was Vietnamese-made originally. Right. But after kind of researching it, you know, just based on the brooch style on the back, it doesn't have... Usually you'll see the pins that come down similar to, you know, the Cross of Gallantry or, you know, other Vietnamese medals. So that's what kind of...
Yeah, I like the soldered ring there.
Yeah. Kind of, you know, a little messy, you know, but it served its purpose. And then even the metal material doesn't have that sheen. It's kind of a dull metal, and, you know. But I just saw it cool, and I spotted it on a table.
Have you tested to see what the construction of that of the planchet is?
No, I didn't. No, I wouldn't. Yeah, I don't think it would need to be anything special.
I'm saying out of curiosity, collecting.
Yeah.
But you could probably call around to some jewelers, see if anybody's got an electrospectrograph or whatever you want to call it. And it could give you the metal composition of that planchet, just out of curiosity what it's made out of.
No, that's true, absolutely. Yeah, because it's definitely not, you know, the same material that
was... Yeah, just tell them you think it's gold and let them test it for you.
Yeah, there you go. I just don't want them to scratch it. I see too many metals where you can tell somebody scratched the back of it.
No. I'm talking about...
I know what you're talking about. Yeah.
Because actually, like, give you the breakdown of the different metals that are in it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, but I'm just saying, I've seen other metals, and people have scratched them, like,
looking for gold in a Purple Heart?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. That's usually what you see. So that was just a pretty cool piece. You know, I thought it was, you know, interesting. It's not the norm. You don't, you know, it's the first one I've ever seen of its kind. So, so a couple other pieces. These are World War I era. So the first one is a war service shipbuilding badge. And so this is actually a civilian badge that would have been worn by, you know, civilians who were building ships for the war effort. And let me see if you can see the back. On the back, there's actually a number on it. And that would be, you know, a distinguishable number for whoever the badge was issued to. And basically, this is specific to Hog Island, which is in Philadelphia. And for nobody that knows, Hog Island is... you know, right near the Philadelphia airport, and it was constructed in around 1918, I believe, and they were building ships for, you know, they actually started right at the start of World War One, or the U.S. involvement in World War One, and were creating merchant ships, you know, for that. They actually never created a ship that was put into service during World War One, though. But, you know, I just thought it was a little interesting, you know, it's a cool little piece, you know, kind of shows that, you know, there was that civilian effort, you know, during World War One. Another interesting fact about Hog Island, it was the birthplace of the hoagie. Nobody ever knew that, so a little bit of Philly history there for you. and another PA item here. So this would be the another war service badge, and this would be for the Eddystone Rifle Factory. And let me just see if I can get a clear picture, if I can focus. Gotta move my head out of the way. So again, this would be, you know, the same thing. It'd been worn by a civilian who was, you know, manufacturing rifles at the Eddystone factory in Eddystone, PA. And there, they would have actually manufactured I think it was the 1914 Enfield rifle, and then the model 1917 Enfield rifle. And, you know, those, a lot of people, you know, equate the Springfield 1903 as the, you know, the rifle that was used predominantly during World War One, but in actuality, it was the model 1917 Enfield that, you know, would have seen the most service during World War One. So, you know, pretty cool piece. And there was actually they actually built artillery at another plant, you know, in the same, in Eddystone, and there was a huge explosion that, you know, destroyed part of the plant, you know, as a result. Mixed a lot of gunpowder, and, you know, somebody probably flicked a cigarette or something. And yeah.
You never know anymore.
Yeah, exactly. So I just thought these were little cool pieces, and it's interesting because on the back of it, it says government property returned to War Department, Washington, D.C. So, you know, somebody must have just walked away with this and, you know, never turned back in. But you'll find these on from time to time. And, you know, not to talk value, but, you know, they can sell for like $30 on eBay, you know, per badge. For, you know, actually, this one a little bit more. This was the only one I've ever seen, but the ship service ones, you know, or shipbuilding ones, these are a little more common. I've seen quite a few of these, you know, out of shows. So, you know, just an interesting little piece of U.S. history.
Cool, man. Yeah, never dull history with you. kind of questions we got out here tonight. Let's see. Well, of course, Sean's over there screwing up our shout-outs. Sean, you're fired.
All
right. Yeah. You forgot Angie Martin.
I know, of all people. Angie Martin. Right?
Oh, man, that was a
loyal subscriber. Man.
Oh, man.
Oh, man, our number one fan. Right?
Well, we didn't forget you, Angie, just Sean. Hey, Sean, you might want to go put a helmet on before that bus hits you.
Sean will send you some wooden nickels. I hear he's got a few of them.
There you go.
You know, people make fun of them, but I've made a lot of money on those wooden nickels. So y'all can just bite me.
he owes you a hat. How about that?
One that's orange.
Well, Kathleen misses Drew's ponytail. I think we all just miss Drew, period. Oh, Drew, what's up, man? We can't hear you. You're muted. He's talking to us, but he doesn't unmute it.
Got stuck in that L.A. traffic, you know.
He's from your backyard.
Between your bedroom and the living room?
Yeah. Yeah, my girlfriend got in the way.
Nice.
I had to take a shot.
What'd you say? You got a new cat? What?
new cats, new clocks. I mean, everybody's just, you know.
Oh, yeah, man. Well, hey, Kathleen misses your ponytail. She's going to send you some.
It's all gone. Going to a good cause, you know, kids with cancer, that's a good thing.
Yeah, man, that's good stuff. And then Berta Bell, seen a bunch of black and white photos, some military men, wondered if I should have picked them up. Berta, if you're on Facebook, snap a picture, shoot me a message, shoot Dan a message, shoot Drew a message, we all do photos.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I just told her in the chat that, yeah, if they're like, you know, military that look like they're deployed, you know, whether it's World War, looks like they're not in the U.S. with their family. You know, some of those are kind of cool when they're in the front yard with their family, but it looks like they're out, you know, in the field. Those are the ones that you want to grab. Yeah, you can research them later. There's all kinds of ways to research them. If you don't know anything about them, you know, just the uniform, the terrain, the type of equipment they're standing around, there's ways to date them and research them. It takes a little bit of time, but between all of us here, we could probably figure it out for you.
Yeah. Well, like, you know, I mean, the bottom line is we all buy stuff that are on the show. So, honestly, if you find stuff that's out there and you're not sure, I mean, just shoot one of us a Facebook message. We're all on Facebook. We're all reachable. You know, shoot us a message. That little Facebook messenger is pretty cool. It's just like using chat and text. You know, so shoot us a message. Somebody will respond to you.
And if it's hooked up, you can call them.
Yeah, I mean, there's all kinds of things. I don't care if you want to call me, you know, whatever. Doesn't matter to me. All I'm saying is that, you know, if, you know, for like me, if I'm not interested in a ref. I don't know. I probably know somebody to send you to. You know, there's going to be somebody out there looking for it, and that's how we find stuff out in the field. I mean, I have people call me all the time. Matter of fact, Chad's over in the chat asking if I got a helmet. I just bought a helmet from him that he pulled out of some junker's garage.
That's a nice helmet, too.
Yeah, it should be a cool piece. I can't wait to get it, but no, it hasn't arrived yet. It'll probably be here tomorrow or something. Of course, you hear my new clock. Fully functional.
Mine are
just like it was new about 115 years ago. But, if you guys do find stuff out there, feel free to shoot us texts and stuff, you know. We're all receptive to it, and you know, you can ask Chad. I pay solid prices for solid pieces. You know, this isn't about trying to get stuff for cheap. You know, I'll pay what it's worth. Obviously, I'm not going to pay retail, but, you know, I'd go broke if I did that. I pay solid prices, and I'm sure these other guys are the same way. We all, you know, if it fits our collections or we know somebody that collects it and it will fit for them, then we're going to be interested, you know. And it's about getting the stuff into the collector's hands. So that it doesn't just end up in the dump. Because honestly, you know, like photos, if somebody doesn't buy a bunch of photos at a yard sale or a flea market or, you know, estate sale, chances are they just get thrown away and then they're gone.
Yep.
You know? So, anyways, moving on from that. No, I haven't gotten the helmet yet. Doesn't look like we got anything else in the chat. So let's go ahead and slide over to our MIA of the night, Drew, and let him get himself introduced, and then we'll jump back to Dan and see what kind of a car show or car club or something car related cool shit that Dan's got over there. So what's up, Drew? Drew's got a Hot Wheels shirt on and you're muted. Muted, Drew. You gotta unmute yourself.
There you go. You don't like my nasty fan noise in the background, but hey guys, I'm Drew, the California Picker. You know me. I have a YouTube channel called California Pickin', and I specialize in fine art, antiques, vintage collectibles, and such. So if you have any questions or what have you, comments, shoot them my way. Back to you.
Awesome, Drew. I'm glad you're able to pop in with us tonight. So what you got, Dan?
All right.
Other than a mouse pad and a crotch shot.
Don't look at me. Stop looking at me.
I had to call you out, man. This is exactly a, you know, I joined this mid-century modern kitsch group. I never knew what kitsch was. And yeah. I figured it out real quick.
Oh, yeah?
It was before my time, but I'll tell you what, it's probably one of the funnest groups I've ever joined on Facebook.
Oh, cool.
Are you, is it mid-century modern? And, because I'm a member on that group.
No, it's the MCM Kitsch, like K-I-T-S-C-H.
Okay, I'll check that out, because I'm on another one, mid-century modern and Los Angeles history and such, that they got a lot of people on there.
Yeah, the Kitsch group is, dude, it is just, it's nuts. Those people are crazily fun.
Yeah.
It's just a fun group. They post all kinds of wacky stuff, you know. But they know they're mid-century modern, and I really enjoy the group, you know. But, without further ado, let's get back to Dan.
Okay, so, yeah, this is something that... I found this weekend, and I've got a video up on YouTube about this that I just put up this week, but I thought I'd share it here because it really falls in heavily into the collectible stuff, and I don't know if I'm going to even sell half the stuff that's in here because some of these are really cool. But anyhow, this lady was in a retirement area, and they were having a community garage sale. So this box was in a bunch of stuff, and if you see, this is an old shoebox. It says here, like, you know, the best in men's footwear, men's home at home footwear, which means slippers, right? It's got this very cool Beals department store, and I don't have those out here, and I don't know if they even exist still anymore. It says $12 on it, but every time that something was put into this box, they wrote on it. It says here fire engine and fireman. And they even put a date, and they marked off stuff as they either took it out. But the most legible thing is this piece of tape that says cars and trucks. It looks like it was added in January of 1988. Johnny Buddy under the tree over here. And then it says all at least 50 years old. So when I opened it up, this is kind of what I got to see. And my heart started beating because there's some really cool old things inside of this box. So one of the things right off the bat was this is this car and this pump. And this was all part of a 1950s, this is about 1953, a 10 gas station set. So it had a whole big platform with like two-story, and it was a whole gas station toy set. But these are some of the accessories for that gas station, and it had this gas pump that actually has a hole in the top that you could put water in. And this hose comes out of the bottom, and then you have this car, the back of the car has a filler valve, where you take this, there's a little piece of metal missing off of here, but you put it here, you can fill this car with, like it's, you're filling it with gasoline. It goes from the filler on this hose into this, the engine compartment, which is actually a just hollowed out little box for the water. And so you can open the hood and check the hood, and it's got an air vent right here on the top. There's a little air vent for the water, so that when they put the water in, you know, that it'll come out. But it's the really neat thing is when you've got it filled up, you can drain it, and you push this little black button that's sticking up right there. You push it down, it's spring loaded, and it opens up a valve in the bottom, that little valve right there, and it dumps the water out. So for me, I was just, this is, look how intricate this thing is. I mean, all the little things that this car does, you know, is just so cool to me. And I don't even know what it is. I think it's a Cadillac. It's made by Keystone. And Keystone were the folks who made the whole gas station set and all the stuff that came with this. So anyhow, that's just one piece that was in there. That alone, like, made my day on this whole box, just seeing that piece over here. Here's this fire truck. This is cast aluminum, which later became known as die-cast. So they still call that die-cast, but this is like the early die-cast. And this has got the tires. They're rubber tires, and the tires are all intact, and it's in really good shape. And this is made by a company called Metal Masters. And I've did some research on it, and I really can't find a whole lot about this company. In fact, it has got the fire department's logos label still on it. It's kind of cool.
I love the streamlined back end there on that fire truck.
Yeah, it's just, this whole thing is sleek. All these cars are just got that nice 40s and, you know, 50s sleek look to them, you know. I like that. Then there's a whole bunch of, evidently the person loved fire trucks and firemen and stuff. This one's kind of neat because of the, it's got the siren and the light still on it, and it's got this antenna. Radio antenna coming off the back.
That's crazy. Here.
And it's all intact, and it's just super cool. And this was a company just called, this is an Acme, ACME, Acme Toy Company. There's a whole bunch of these. It's made out of plastic. This is probably early 60s. Here's another
We got a question, Dan, from Wheeling and Dealing with Wheelie 5. Is one of those a renewal car? I have a small red plastic one for sale now.
You know what? I do have one in here. This right here is a renewal. I can't find one like it. It's clear plastic, hard plastic. It's got the logo, you know, for it. It's got a number 16 on the top of it. It's hard to see because it's all clear. But yeah, this is a renewal. And I tried researching this. I can't find one like this anywhere. I've looked on eBay and Googled this, and I can't really find this particular car. I've been trying to look for that one, and so I have no idea anything about some of these. I think there's another renewal in here. Yeah, this is an American. Yeah, this is another renewal. This is a renewal right here. It's a little dusty still. This is neat. The guy's still sitting in there. The tires are still intact. It's got hard plastic tires. And yeah, this is a renewal also. And all right, these. I need to get another. I gotta move some of those out of the way. Too much room. This one and this one. Is real interesting because they are they're made by a company called Manoil, M-A-N-O-I-L, and there's both of these. They are they were made for American Flyer, the train company, the model train company, and they were actually flatbed loads for back of a flatbed car. They came with American Flyer flatbed car as a load, so somebody's missing the load. I got the cars, but I don't have the flatbed. So somebody needs a load for the flatbed. I got them here. So this one's really good shape. This is painted pretty well. The outside's got some chips, but the he's in pretty good shape. And these are 50s. These are mid-50s, those two there. And let's see. One of the things, the coolest one in here. Oh, here's one here. Oh, it's missing a wheel. This is a Auburn. And Auburn made a lot of rubber toys. All their toys were made out of rubber. And this is actually made out of rubber. It's a hard black rubber that's painted. And I'll try to hold it here still so you can get a better view of it. But they got real fragile. They break really easy because that rubber dries out and just turns to like crispy glass and then it just disintegrates. But the wheel's really not missing. I found the wheel in the box. It's inside of this little roll of masking tape, but it's cracked in half. So I kind of have a wheel. I guess you could say I do have the wheel. It's not quite all there.
It's
but
cool somebody thought to save that, though, you know?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, now this one, this is a really intriguing one here. This one is made by Barclay. And there's no markings on it for that name, but I did do some research and found this. It's a car carrier, and I have four cars for it. They're all cast die-cast, cast aluminum. The truck part is a die-cast also, die-cast aluminum. This is a steel, the trailer steel. And not only, let's see, I got all four here. They don't stay on very well. The back one. I think there's a little piece missing here in the back that anyhow goes on or something like that. But not only do I have all this, there were a lot of extra cars for this set. So it's like someone had been either had multiple of these trailers and I'm seeing all these. I'm seeing these are. All these are cars around and in a set with this, but the idea with this toy is it goes like this. So when you're playing with your, you unload the bottom, well somehow, you unload the top, they come off. There might have been another ramp, and then this thing comes back and it becomes like a ramp. Like this becomes like a ramp for the cars.
I'm
playing with my cars. Okay, load them up, guys. All right, load your truck up.
Hey, so, Bernard Picker says that clear car is a candy dispenser.
Oh, wow.
Oh, really?
I was going to say, is it a model that you painted?
Does it look like it would have a bottom to it?
It could have had a cardboard like insert, a cardboard insert.
A lid or something.
Yeah, it may have had like full of candy, little candy, and had a cardboard insert, you know, filling it. There's a little groove in the edge here where a cardboard insert would have fit in there and could have.
What I also noticed, and you guys just picked up on that, it doesn't have an axle. It's all made, you know, so it's axle free. So there was a little covering, and I think it did hold candy.
It had something in it.
Yep.
Yeah. Cool,
man. Hey, that's why we love our viewers.
Yeah, thanks. That's good. That's a good point, because this was one of the ones that I was probably I had the least knowledge on, because I did look it up real quick and I couldn't. We couldn't find anything on it, and so that's cool. Good information. Thanks.
That is a good observation, Drew, that there was no axle.
Yeah. Hey, Dan, does it have little tabs to hold in like a bottom, like a tray or something that slid in somehow?
It looks like right here there's a little insert.
Yeah. Yeah.
Where that if it had a piece of cardboard would have just pressed in there and probably held candy in it.
Oh.
Cool. Hey, Chad, thanks for the shout out, man. We'll great Q&A earlier. If we got viewers that haven't checked it out, go check out the Golden Finger Picker channel. Check out his Q&A, his picking videos. He's always finding crazy cool stuff, and he loves reselling to resellers. So go check out his stuff. Great guy. Thanks again, Chad. And we'll make sure to catch up with you. And I'll let you know when that helmet gets here. All right, back to the show.
All right.
This
is just a whole assortment of all the other things that were in here. Let's see, I already showed that. There's a whole bunch of these tiny ones. Lido. Lido is the name of a company, and I've seen that around. This is the truck and trailer for that. What else we got here?
It's funny, Dad, you don't have any dinky toys. I'm used to those as being dinky toys.
Yeah. Some of these just don't have anything. This was made in Hong Kong. So some of these may not be that old. This is a friction car here. Got a little friction motor in it. Clear plastic.
Cool.
It's clear plastic.
Yeah, that is cool.
Just a whole bunch of little, and these are all old. None of these, I don't think, are reproduction or modern. I think these are all definitely from the 60s, maybe 50s and 60s. This is a neat little fire truck set, fire car, truck, and all this stuff right here. Same scale. Here's another friction car. And this one's got Japan written in the back of it right here. It's hard to see. But on the back it says Japan embossed on the back of the metal. And this is metal. That's kind of a neat car. But, I don't know the names of companies or anything. So, that's pretty much it. That's all that was in this box. Then this thing here. This is made in Italy. I'm sorry, made in Israel. Craigstan, C-R-A-G-S-T-A-N, Craigstan, and it's a die-cast car. It's early die-cast. They from the 60s. So it was when they first started. They started doing this style of die-cast in the early 60s. But it's a Chevelle ambulance, and the box acts like a garage. So this is like a garage door. I can't open it. It slides up and open, and then you can drive your car out. Actually, you can pull it out. It's in this little frame. So it kind
of reminds me of a Corgi toy.
It does look like one, doesn't it? The same,
yeah.
Same style. But the box is Detroit SR Craigston made in Israel.
Ooh, interesting.
Yeah, that's different. They're all fairly old, so
I don't think I've ever seen a toy that's made in Israel.
Yeah.
Except a dreidel,
So now we take a huge, huge turn here. Well, no, let me stick with the cars. I do have a few things. I just got this stuff, just got these today. I've shown the guys. I'm going to show you real quick because I just think this stuff is so cool.
Quick questions there, Dan.
Okay.
Let's see. Joseph Hare, which, good to see you, even though we can't physically see you. Glad you're here. he's always good for a joke or two. He gets a little annoying, but anybody named Joseph does. But have you heard of Hing Gecko Vanities Incorporated Company? Because that makes a lot of sense. Hing Gecko Vanities Incorporated.
No.
Never heard of that, Dan?
No, I haven't.
We'll have to Google it. Give me a minute and I'll Google it. And then Andrew Martin wants to know if you're going to be eBaying those, Dan.
Some of them I have already. I got a few up there right now. Actually, I sold one today. But, yeah, I'm still going through them to figure out. But, yeah, I am. I know that this we do mostly collectibles and stuff, but I just like, I mean, that would be my collection if I could afford to keep those. I would keep them. I just have a shelf and have all these little cars all over the place, but that would be my collection. So that's a cool way to start. Because I like automotive stuff a little bit, too, and that's why I'm going to show you these real quick. So I come upon a whole bunch of really nice T-shirts that are, that's just a piece of lint, yeah. So it was like Blair's Speed Shop in Pasadena.
Any fat man sizes?
Well, let's see, it's an extra large. Does that count?
Oh, no, never mind. Probably all the same then.
Yeah, and let me go through these real quick. There's just cool graphics on these, and I don't know where this place is at. This is in the valley, so it might be in like Sacramento and in the Central Valley, California. It's got signatures here, signature of the artist down here too. So on these, but there's these Speed Shop pick shirts. I got a whole bunch of them. Same company. That's the same one, huh? Where's my girly one? Not my girly one. This is a cool one. Got these old hot rods on them. I like this artwork, this pinstriping type artwork. And I'll bet that the artist that did this, probably a pinstriper, you know, that did that kind of work for the shirt. And this is a cool one. Born Bad. That's a really nice. Grab this guy real quick. Another solo Speed Shop. I'm going to have to find this place. I don't know where the solo Speed Shop was at. Here's another solo Speed Shop one. Nice hot rod there. And then, here's my favorite. It's got a picture of Angie Martin on it. So Angie, got your picture here.
They're horrible people.
That's cool.
Angie Martin wants to see the blue Ford again.
All right, wait. Here, I got two of them, I think. This one?
Probably. And then she said, oh, the Born Bad she liked. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she's a car person. She likes the car stuff.
So my mom would like that one.
Yeah, she sure would have. Very nice. Okay, well now I'm venturing really far away from toys and shirts and cars. We're going down to Argentina to the Amazon jungle and show you what I acquired here in the last few weeks that not quite that kind of an Indian, but Yanomami. It's a Yanomami Indian from the Amazon, one of the secluded tribes that live and survive in the Amazon. And they used to be like unknown. Somebody discovered them, you know. And then first of all, let me show you. So these are, there's two. I don't know if you can see those barbs on the end of these. These are metal.
Put your hand behind them on the other side. Yeah, kind of better. A little better.
See the barbs? See the barbs on there? Like, once that goes in, it's having a hard time coming out.
Oh, yeah.
Or it's going to hurt when it comes out, that's for sure. So this whole thing is a bow. It's actually two bows. They're really short bows. This is one real small one. And it's made out of a really hard wood. It might be like rosewood, but I'm not sure. It's a really hard wood. Try to get a. So there's this. Now, this is just string. This kind of throws me off. Somebody put string on here. I don't think these had originally had like just regular string. This I'll tell you the story behind it here in the middle. This is a longer one. But the guy got this from, belonged to his father, and his mother and father in the 70s took a trip into Argentina, and they wanted to tour Argentina, but they wanted to go into the Amazon where, you know, most people don't go. They were all, a lot of people advised them against going down there on their own like that because it was really dangerous. A lot of people go into those jungles, tourists, and they never come out again, and there's that kind of thing. So they worked it out, and they went down there, and they spent a month traveling around and basically living off the beaten trail with these Yanomami Indians that are surviving and living on their own down there. And that's where they got this. They got this set from the tribes people down there. And that's this guy's story. One of the other neat things that's in here is there's actually a blowgun.
Oh, wow.
And the blowgun is missing, it is missing a mouthpiece. There was supposed to be some kind of a thing here that was like a mouthpiece on this end of it. But you can see here. But it has the dart. So here's the dart. It's just a carved piece of wood. It's real pointy at this end. But what they would do is they would take a fiber of some kind and kind of wrap it around here to cause the, you know, the seal. And then they would stick it in. They would stick it in, and then it would pack it in there with, because the end of it was all wrapped up. And then they could.
It also put some frog poison on there.
Yeah, you know what?
Damn frogs.
I've been touching this and starting to get real sleepy.
let me see the so-called bow. I'm not sure if that is a bow.
Well,
could that be a fire starter?
I don't know. The little one. Well, see, here's the deal. Be. Look at this one. This one's kind of a flat shape, and it's
okay.
It's
does not, one of the does one of the threads or the rope does it detach from that?
Yeah. Well, they could. They're just tied. It's just tied.
I'm thinking it's like a fire starter. You know, you kind of use the tension and then maybe the other pieces.
This one is longer, but it's more round.
See, for it to be a bow, it would have to be very arced and very pulled into place. That doesn't look like...
Well, here's the deal. This stuff bends. This thing bends. And it has some oomph. See how it... I don't know if you can see the arc.
You know what I was originally thinking? You know how they hold one end, and then it's like a throwing stick, and you get more. But you know what? I'm not sure on that.
No, because I've seen those, and they have there's actually a notch in the end to hold the spear.
That's right,
and they're
the
really
end,
long
right.
too. They're way longer than these.
Yeah,
they're real long. Now these may have at one time when I was looking up the arrows and things from those tribes, they may have had some feathers in there. Stabilize it, and they probably have all rotted away because this basket is kind of cool too. This is the basket that it was all in.
Yeah,
it's all woven in. Being that they were down in that basket, they probably
still there.
you know, I never shook it out.
A little bit of it.
Yeah. Hey Dan.
Yeah.
Here, I'm gonna share this image.
Okay.
The American Indians would call the thing that the arrows are held in, they would call it a quill.
Yeah. Or quiver.
Quiver. Yeah, I'm not sure if the... Yeah, quiver, right. I'm not sure if the Africans call it that, though. Or where is this from? This is the Yanomamo.
Yanomami.
Yeah.
So here you go, Dan. This is what I think you have.
All right.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
So you would basically use a stick that would wrap between the string, and you'd have a smaller piece at the bottom of wood, and you'd put kind of your fiber or some type of something that would catch fire quickly, and then you would run it back and forth, and the tension or rather than using your hands to spin the wood in the center there, you would use a string to do that.
Here's the part that has a lot more of a curve to it.
Is there a hole in the other piece? So is the other piece like flat, and is there like a little divot in the center of the other piece?
No, neither one. But both of them have these, the ends where the string go, are are really carved down pointy, and I would think that if you were to pull that to try to do fire starter, it would break this piece off, because it's pretty...
Okay.
I mean, even...
But then how would a bow work? A bow would even put more stress on
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
But, you know, I've never tried shooting this. Let me see what happens. I was afraid I'd break it.
Well,
it's got a nice notch in there. Where's my dog? Kylie, come here. Kylie, run. Hurry, run. Yeah, this wouldn't work because you don't get enough.
Yeah, that's
you don't really get enough. No. Well, I don't know, man.
No.
I don't want to break the tip on. Now, this one would probably do it. This one's longer. So maybe one was. Oh, this one's got some oomph. This one
if you think about if you think about it, he's out in the field and he's got all his equipment to shoot an animal, and then he's got that other stick to start a fire.
Yeah, it could be possible.
I got a whole survival kit.
There you go.
Maybe so.
A whole survival kit.
Those are cool.
And these things are small enough. This is probably for birds. I'm sure you're not going to take down. I don't know, I guess you could take down a rabbit or something, but these are probably for birds. And this is really tightly wound wire on here or something too. So I don't know. I got it and I got a good feel on it. It was pretty cheap, but I was really intrigued.
And the blowgun's for shooting monkeys. It is.
Or if you're good, you can shoot a bird.
They eat monkeys.
Yeah. So anyhow, I have this clock I got this a little while ago. I just got this kind of in this condition, and it's a little rough. This one's a French clock, and what was really neat about it is that this is the pendulum for it. It's pretty ornate. It's all made out of brass. And it does need some work.
Hopefully what you're going to do with that is take it out back and turn it into kindling. We don't like the French.
Yeah, I'm okay with it. I'm going to... It's been cracked, and it's got some wood damage, but I'm deciding whether I'm going to gut it. Sorry, I'm about to sneeze.
Yeah,
I think the frog poison on the...
Gutting the French sounds good.
Sorry, the poison on the end of this dart got me.
There you go. Touch your face after you touch the poison dart.
And what does it kill you makes you stronger, Dan.
There you go. So anyhow, I got this. It's got a cool etched. The glass is etched right here. There's a piece that goes this piece up here, which is broken off, goes up here, and it was really ornate. I mean, I paid like $15 for this. So. I know how to fix it, so I'm going to tear it apart. I'm going to work on the movement. If I get the movement working, then I'll decide what to do with the rest of it.
That's about $90 less than my clock.
So that's the way I kind of do it. When I see these kind of sitting around, because nobody's going to buy this, because no one, if it doesn't work, nobody wants to mess with a clock, and I'm willing to. So I try to rescue it if I can, and I'll see what I can get. If I can get it to just work, I'll just glue the other pieces on there, and I'll just get it to work, and I'll hang it on my wall, and as long as it'll run.
See, I'm the gambler. I never actually wound mine up until yesterday, and I bought it last week.
Oh, wow.
But it, the condition was good, so I felt confident about it. Well, great, Dan. Thanks for the plethora of awesome stuff you showed us tonight. I was going to jump over to Drew, but he seems to be MIA again. So, I'll just start going with my pile of junk that I'm going to share tonight. We got anybody new in the chat, Sean, or is it same old same?
Pretty much the same people.
All right, cool. Well, hey, I'm glad everybody's sticking with us, and we're going to keep getting through this show and sharing some stuff. Keep throwing us your questions. We'll answer everything that we can. But since we left with Dan talking about a clock, we'll go over to the... the Germans, instead of the damn French. And, actually, I don't know. Can you guys see that all right? I don't know if, do I need to take it down, or can you see it?
I can pretty much see it, I think.
Yeah?
Except the top.
Well, there is no top on it.
Oh, okay. Well, then that's pretty much it.
This one doesn't have a top. a straight shelf, but it is a German clock with a porcelain face, winds up, it chimes. I haven't been able to specifically date it yet, but it's somewhere in the early 1900s. The only real interesting thing, and I know you can just see the white, but it's actually got a scale at the bottom. I haven't quite figured that out yet. Dan, do you know what that is for?
Yeah, that's how you center, that's how you know to center it on the wall. So if you watch the pendulum swing from one side to the other, it's supposed to help you set the beat of the clock so that it's a steady, because you know if you have it crooked on the wall, it's going to always swing to one side and it'll stop or it makes a different sound. That's what it's for. It's supposed to help the normal consumer to center the clock on the wall. So you watch the full swing and it goes to the same gauge on each side of center. It should go the same distance each side of center as it. That's how you're supposed to be able to set it.
Because I mean, this thing's been running.
Yeah.
Yesterday morning.
The easiest way to set there, it's called setting it in beat. So that means, you know, that's basically what it means. It's the beat of the clock. If you listen really closely, and you'll hear that it may make two different sounds. It makes a different one sound going one way and another sound coming back. That means it's off beat. To get it on beat, you want it to sound the same way each swing. So going one way, it sounds the same click and the same click. So it's always clicking the same sound. You can tell. It's just like, I guess if you're a drummer, you are better at listening to that. I don't know. But it's called getting it on beat, so you can listen to it. Now, they make an amplifier, which is really interesting, that you click to the inside of your clock, the movement, which amplifies that beat that the clock's making as it's ticking so that you can hear it better. And then most guys that are really, really good, I'll click that up and just go, okay. And you can set it. That's how you – then you would adjust the beat. In your case, if it's on the wall, you could just – move the clock one way or another. The problem is sometimes if a clock's off beat, your clock may be way, way over here, so it looks crooked on the wall, but it's running great. You know, you don't want that. So you can go up inside and in the back, and you actually bend part of the downspring so that the suspension spring on the back, there's a place you bend, and it sets it in beat. It sets it so it swings right in the center, and you can adjust it. But anyhow. That's my clock.
Cool, man. Hey, tons of info. I you know, my thing is from a collector point of view, I don't know a lot about clocks. From a seller point of view, I know enough to sell them.
Yeah.
You know?
So that's
I was pretty excited. I haven't quite decided if I'm going to keep it or let it go. Next week I'll be in my new office, finally. So I might just hang it up in there and think it'll start ending up looking like Dan's walls.
Yeah.
So, but it was cool. It came with its, you know, the original key.
Is that piece in the middle of the pendulum, is that porcelain? That white
No, that looks painted.
Is the face
it's got a lot of crazing on it. It looks like it's painted.
Oh, okay.
So now the face is porcelain.
Yeah, okay.
And it doesn't have any cracks, just a little bit of wear around around where you insert the key. And, well, like you saw earlier, I set the hour hand, had to go ahead a little bit. But other than that, the minutes have stayed dead on since yesterday.
Yeah.
And it chimes at the 30 and chimes at the 60.
No, that's cool. The porcelain face and everything, that's a nice...
Is the ticker kind of loud?
Not really. I mean, you can't hear it.
That's good, because I have one that's a little bit loud, and you either like to have to like that noise, or that noise starts to bother you.
Yeah, because
it's like
door open right now, and you can't hardly hear it. Yeah. I'm sure on the speaker.
It's like the seconds are ticking away in your life, and you're like, oh my god.
My living room.
I'll even play it for you.
My living room has.
We're gonna go forward.
My living room has 16 clocks in it. And they all tick. So it sounds, and they're all, sometimes they're in sync, sometimes they're not. I love standing in the middle of the room, just listen to them and see, you can hear them go in sync together sometimes. This is all these weird sounds going.
It's like Doc Brown's laboratory.
Visitors will sleep in there today.
No, my kids used to stop them because they hated the sound.
I've acquired before, so.
Did I ever show you guys my archtop reverse painted mantle clock here on Catacomb?
No, I don't think so.
Okay. I'll go grab it. It's a good one.
Yeah, go get that. We'll talk about some clocks tonight.
Kathleen's asking about the age of that clock.
Yeah.
From what I've acquired so far, I haven't pulled anything out, looked for stamps, numbers, nothing. From what I know so far, it's early 1900.
Yeah.
And it is German made.
Yeah, I kind of could see it was German. So yeah, I think it might be even earlier than that, but I don't know. But yeah, if you look
could
on
be,
the...
Like I said, I haven't pulled it apart at all.
Right.
Here goes the ding.
Oh yeah.
It's got a good gong to it.
Nice dong.
What's cool is I didn't do anything to it. All I did was set it up and wind it, you know?
Wow, that's what she said.
Oh, my God. Are we derailing this show? Hey, I've derailed enough of Sean Stone's. He just won't talk about dead people. How about that? Alright, so moving on from that. I know I got kind of boring and long on that, but I got some other cool stuff, and I'm leaving Mid-Century Modern for last, so you people are stuck watching me. Because I know that's what everybody wants, but who doesn't like to play a little football?
There you go. I had one of those. Wow.
Yeah, a little 77 Mattel Electronics.
Yeah, baby.
The flea market. Oh, we don't talk for money.
That's the holy grail.
Yeah.
This one's pretty cool. I got a buddy of mine at the Federal Building that collects these. He's actually got a couple of these new in the box.
Oh, man.
You can still find them. I'd be surprised. I mean, you can still find them new in the box.
I was sitting playing a couple weeks ago. I was playing basketball in his office. I'm like, it's pretty wild. So we got that.
Pickers have to be careful though out there because Walmart has some that are.
Repros.
This is definitely
Don't just grab them. Grab them and look.
Yeah, there's a lot of companies that are starting to reproduce.
Yeah, that's a vintage one now. You can.
Yeah, if you want to check it, you know, the back's gotta look, have the age, and I mean, you can see it right above the battery compartment, Mattel.
Yeah, I'm not jumping cars. I'm just letting everybody know that they're out there now. So.
The biggest thing you want to look for on these when you get them is you want to open up the compartment in the back. See, like this one, I mean, I only paid a quarter for the damn thing. So I really didn't care because I'm going to give it away to my buddy. But you can see the corrosion that's in this one.
Yeah.
The dude was smart. He put a new battery in it. Well, semi-new. So that way it worked. So even though it's got the corrosion in there, I still paid the quarter for it because it still works. So what's cool about it is this is the kind of one that, like, if you want to sit and screw around and play or let your kids play, stuff like that. You don't really care because there's really not much collector value to it. Yeah, I mean, honestly, somebody would probably only pay like $5 for it. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because of that corrosion.
I wonder how much a new one sell for.
I have no idea. Probably like $15 or something. I bet you they're not really expensive.
They're $14.99 at Walmart.
So, I'll jump on over to a little vintage. Get into some treasure craft of Hawaii. Made in Maui, number 510. Nice little dish. I love this older pottery. Just the glazing work.
That would fit into the tiki category too, or go alongside it.
Yeah, tiki was talking about. I've also seen some of this in the mid-century modern world as well. People that like the dishes and stuff from that time period.
Mm-hmm.
So I just, I don't know, I like the glazing. I thought it was cool. But let's see, what else can we go? Go from there to do a little Militaria. No, well, not really military, more like Chotsky Militaria. Good old Shirley, the wife of some Tech Squadron 83 pilot. You can see wings on the back. This is a nice heavy-duty coffee mug. This is actually made by B&M Ceramics. I looked them up. They're out of Florida. At the time this was made, they were in Jacksonville. They are in, let's see, Winter Haven, Florida now, but they've been in business since 1981. So it is a nice, you know, wholesale pottery mug that had their unit printed on it.
Don't call me Shirley.
What's that?
Don't call me Shirley.
Yeah. So then I got another set. Apparently she was married to Ed. So we got Ed and Shirley. And I haven't been able to identify, I haven't posted a picture of this yet, but there's whatever attack squadron or squadron he belonged to at that time. And these ones are unbranded. They're just vintage coffee mugs. But just cool little pieces, you know. That's the kind of stuff if somebody collects the things from those units. You know, the little items like that gives them something that they can just continuously add to their collection. So, and then I guess last but not least, so that way I can leave some time for Drew, here's my mid-century modern piece of the night. And I actually haven't decided if I'm going to resell these or if I'm going to keep them. But I've got a set of four of these steak trays. And you could tell the feet give it away, the construction, and these are actually made by Cutco.
Yeah, those are cool.
They are. Let's see if I can get that lined up where you can see it. Yeah, I might not, but they're Cutco 1144s is the number on them. Yeah. These are made in the 70s, made in the USA.
Yeah, those had some matching steak knives and steak and fork knives, forks and shit, yeah.
Yeah, Cutco made all kinds of stuff during that time, but yeah, these are pretty cool. I don't know. Yeah, they're heavy because it's the platform. This is steel.
Steel, yeah.
That's underneath. And then it's got little rubber feet that keep the ceramic tray from touching the metal.
Yeah.
I haven't even cleaned these up. I just got them like 2 days ago.
Probably walnut on the wood.
I'm not sure. I want to say it's teak.
Yeah, I was going to say teak or walnut.
It's not quite dark enough, I think, to be walnut. And it's not very heavy. Uh-huh. Like, there's no weight in handles. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It feels very, very lightweight. I don't know if you can catch the grain on it or not. Sure. You know, my camera's not very great.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, I think they're teak. And maybe somebody that knows a little bit more about Cutco steak trays will know what it's made out of, you know? Who's leaving? Joe Panico. See you, Joe. So that's my mid-century modern piece for the evening. So I didn't lie in the title. I promised I would show something mid-century modern. I know everybody's screaming for it. I'm really hoping that some folks from the Kitsch group will want to come on. I've been advertising a little bit over there to see if somebody wanted to come check it out and share their collection. A lot of cool stuff out there, so. All right, well, that's my stuff for the evening. We'll shoot over to Drew. What you got for us, Drew?
Let's just get right into it, Eric. This is a cool Krockstein, German beer stein. It's got a cool mallard duck on the top there. And it's got these great scenes all the way around it. Now, I kind of knew that this wasn't a really old one. I could just tell. But it's got some nice designs here, kind of, you know, Italian Majolica-esque. And it's by a company called Gertz. G-R-E-Z. And it's called, up here it says Old Gertz. And this is some German I don't read. But pretty nice Stein, found it at the Goodwill. $4.99.
So like 50, somewhere 50, 60, 70s probably, because it's West Germany. So.
Yeah, West Germany, exactly. Yeah. And that's why I picked it up.
Computer attachments on there.
What's that?
Are those are the lid attachments pewter?
Pewter, yeah. The good ones are all pewter. And it's heavy. The pewter is heavier. The newer ones are white metal, pot metal, really schlocky. This has got a good quality to it. It's also got a some type of logo or something in here.
Maybe you could find the maker and see if the logo changed and really get a date to it.
Yeah. And you know what? I looked these up. I was hoping for a little bit more profit on this one. I'm just going to make three times profit, probably. Three or four times profit.
Oh, only three times. I feel so sorry for you.
But you know me, my thing is 10 times profit. So,
well, Drew, we can't all be rich like you, man.
Yeah, no, not rich, just I drive a hard bargain. This is a beautiful item. I picked this up at a flea market. I did a video on this some time ago. And it's some type of light fixture.
Oh.
Yeah, it kind of looks like an urn.
Yeah, it looks like it, but yeah.
But all this is really nice metal. You got these little urns and swag detail kind of thing all the way around.
That's my grandma's urn.
All this is slag glass. Let me see if I can light this up here.
Grandma, where'd you go?
Grandma, I wondered where you were at.
I don't know.
You're over at Drew's house.
But anyways, this is all curved glass. That each little thing is inserted.
Yeah.
Look at that. It's all curved and segmented and then pinned in there with little tabs.
I think you should keep cookies or candy in there.
This is so old school, man. This is there's
the
wire.
Grail, somebody says.
There's where the wire used to go.
Oh, and yeah.
So what I'd like to rewire this thing would be great, because it's just nice. Got a great look to it. And I just liked it for my own collection. I don't think I was gonna resell that.
Drew, just to let you know on that Gerstein, I just looked it up real quick. Apparently,
yeah.
There's a couple of different Stein hallmark sites that are great, but it looks like Gers used West Germany. They used a couple of different hallmarks, but they used them all from 49 to 90. There's no periods where they used different marks. So anything from Gers that says West Germany was just 49 to 90.
If somebody offered Drew 10 times more what he paid for it, I'll bet he'd sell it.
Oh no! I'm gonna take the three times profit on it. That's okay. It's like 20. They're like $20 to $25. You know.
Yeah.
Now, if you have the bigger version, they come in larger ones. If you look on the search them, they come very much larger too. So.
How old it is? Andy Martin was wondering if it's 1930s.
On the Stein.
No, on the
The lamp, 1920s or 30s, I would say that's a good guess. And it looks like it's mostly brass. It's got all that great detail around the edges. And so this is my pride and joy clock. This is probably one of the best clocks I've ever bought.
Oh, wow.
It gets better the higher you go.
Yeah,
and let's say it's an Ingram made in Connecticut, and this is a really old clock. It's called an Archtop and it's got first painted glass. And I want you guys to look how unique this door is. It's like a figure eight door.
Oh, yeah.
And it opens all in one.
That's neat.
And there you got your reverse painted glass right here.
Wow.
Pretty much intact. And then it's got a label. It's got a label way at the back.
Yeah.
Original Ingram brass clock. And it's somewhere around, I think this clock is about 1880s or something like that. Somewhere in there. And now this shape is called a beehive also. It's been talked about as a beehive arch top, you know, but I think it's just a straight arch top. It's mahogany. Looks like it's mahogany all the way around. And the door is really incredible how it's made like that.
Mm-hmm.
That's unique.
Yeah, that's pretty unique. Let me show you the dial's kind of messed up. It needs to be repainted or refinished.
Yeah, I do.
But yeah, nice old Ingram. And it chimes on the hour, only on the hour. I don't think it chimes on the half hour.
Interesting.
And then,
do you keep that one wound and use it, or does it just sit on the mantle?
It sits on the mantle. I kind of, some of the, like I said, sometimes it bothers me that noise.
Oh, yeah.
But other times it's pretty relaxing, you know, I must say. Here's a great find for you Militaria collectors.
Yeah, nice Marine Corps.
There we go.
World War One, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you get any closer on the collar?
Yeah, it looks like a Marine Corps. Can't tell if it's just the circle or an actual EGA.
Yeah, because it's kind of hazy.
It does now. Take a look at the collar, Drew, since you can see it better than us. Does he have an EGA on there? Eagle Globe Anchor from the Marine Corps?
He's got some cross swords.
There's swords on it?
That's a cavalry.
Yeah, the cross swords around a circle. And then the buttons he has, of course, American Eagle.
Yeah, so it's a U.S. cavalry soldier.
And he's got one bar on his shoulder, one
lieutenant.
Either first or second lieutenant, yeah.
Right here.
It looks like an EGA from a distance. I got all excited. Marine Corps stuff, especially World War One, is just very sought after.
Right.
Tell me what
would be the difference? This guy's cavalry and not Marines, or?
Yeah, Marine stuff just is, it's not as plentiful as, you know, the other, Army. Yeah.
So here this is
the name. Hold on, Mo. I'm going to let you go into talking about it right after you tell me what the name is, and I might be able to find something during the show.
I was just going to say the same here.
Okay, I'll get to that in a second, because the name is hard to make out. But here, it's a New York photographer, Brooklyn, New York, and we have an address, which is very cool, Fulton Avenue. Now on the back, and by the way, this address of the photographer is embossed into the paper. So on the back here, you guys tell me what this guy's name is.
It says Joe.
Joe?
C-R?
Read the letters to us, Drew, the best you can.
All right, this is really hard because it's really, you know, when somebody writes their name, they should be able to write their name, you know, legibly. But it says Joe C-R-I... LTENDEV or DEN. It's so weird. It's like, I can't even.
Probably Crittleton. That's probably pretty close.
Yeah, no records for Crittleton.
C-R-I-T-T-E-N-D-E-N, Crittenden?
Could be C-R-I. L T E N Seven or D, yeah, I don't know. And then this, right after that, it says G. I don't know the first word, but the second word is GA. I think that is Georgia, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
And it says S-H-E-L-L-E-A-R-A. Shillerite? I don't know. I wish I could read this stuff.
Is that Joe or does it say Jaws?
No, it's Joe.
It is Joe. Okay.
It's definitely Joe. Kerr.
Oh, I'm not getting any matches on any of the... trying all different types of spellings on the last name.
Yeah, this is so difficult to make it out. Let's see. C-R-I-L-T-E-N-D-E-N. I don't know. But I thought of you guys when I came across it. He's got a nice underbite, you know? He's got his jaws sticking out a little bit. So what do you guys think? What do you guys think of that? It's kind of a larger size, you know. It's not. It's eight. Looks like it's not 8x10, but it's not small.
No, that's a good piece.
Yeah.
So there is a. Oh no, wait, that's too early. So you said it was Georgia, right? Is the
Oh wait, let me look up. Let me tell you the name of the photographer. I don't know if that would help you. Gardner and Sons. 489 Fulton Street, Brooklyn. Yeah, it's a bummer. I looked in the back and I was like, got excited because it had his name, but sorry, you guys. I just too hard to read. All right, moving on for my last item.
Wait, what was the other part of Georgia? Can you say that again?
I couldn't even tell you, like, it's Shell...
Shallow Ford?
Shellier...
There's a Joseph Crittenden born in 1888, who was in Shallow Ford, Georgia, and he was in the militia. Militia Dristic 1334, he appears there.
Huh.
You said Joseph Crittenden?
Crittenden, so C-R-I-T-T-E-N-T-O-N.
Yeah, I'm not sure if that's a D or a T, but it looks more like a D. And then he might not have crossed, but he only crossed one T. I don't know if it's Shallowford, but...
No, that guy was black, Eric. Can't be him.
Okay. There's another Joseph Crittenden, born 1896 in Georgia. And then he was, it says, Militia District 1334. So he was in... See, he was white, born in Georgia. This is the 1910 census. I don't have my ancestry access anymore, so...
Just give me a second. I'll go check it out. See what you did, Drew. We're gonna run over on the show tonight because we're gonna sit here and try to figure out who the hell's in that photo.
Yeah. So, and then lastly, I did a video on this. I don't know if you guys got to see this, but this beautiful big oil painting.
Nice. Was that a student piece?
No, but I think it's like a skilled artist, but not like classically trained. It's kind of stylized.
Right.
But look how big it is.
That's huge.
Yeah, it's huge.
Nicely done, though.
Yeah. I'm getting a lot of glare in here.
What's the canvas? Is the canvas nailed and everything?
In fact, you know what? I wish it was. That's interesting you say that because it's stapled, and therefore And therefore, I'm thinking it's probably from the 50s or 60s.
Right. Either that or it was remounted, but you'd probably be able to tell if it was cut.
Yeah. I don't think it was, and I think somebody was just painting in a classic Renaissance style, but they weren't extremely great at the detail, so they just stylized it. And it's just a lovely painting, and we got a really good deal on it. And I did a little frame restoration on it recently, so that was kind of fun. And that's pretty much it.
Cool, man.
But yeah, we gotta find out who this guy is.
I'm looking.
Yeah.
What else? We're probably gonna bore the viewers, but what the hell else could this say? I mean, I'll let you look at it again.
Let me see.
Ooh, perfect. That was
C-R-I-L-T-A.
N or E-N?
Everybody's like looking at like our nose up and eyes because we're all
but
like.
There's another word
we get closer to
that.
The screen, we can see it better.
Maybe his last name is not Crittenden. Maybe it's that other name that's Davis.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. That might be his middle name.
He looks like Davis. Joe Davis?
Nah, it's not a capital letter. It definitely flows together.
And then Shell, it looks like Shell. Shell Georgia. Where did I say that guy was from?
I said Georgia.
Well, no. What was the one that I was, I lost it.
Shenford or Shell.
Yeah, Shellford. Shellford
yeah,
or Shellford.
Yeah, but there's no for, there's no F on there.
Lost to bad handwriting.
Yeah, that's a shame, but we're going to find out. I think we're going to
find out. Yeah, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out by the next show.
Yeah.
All right, folks. Hey, thanks for tuning in. I'm glad you joined us for episode number 20. Hope we didn't bore you. Hope you had a good time. Thanks again to Chad for his Q&A earlier. Hopefully he does more of those. Go check out the AlliedMilitariaForum.com. Check out everybody's YouTube channels. Check out the Toadcast Friday night. Check out all the other shows going on. And go out there and find some cool stuff and send us pictures. Good night.
Hey, bye, everybody.